Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming this early to attend this exciting event. We are excited about the Tropical Soybean for Development Workshop. This workshop has been organized by the Soybean Innovation Lab, which is one of our research programs that have been awarded last year to the University of Illinois, and the director of lab, Dr. Peter Goldsmith, with us here today. And if you want to learn more about the Soybean Innovation Lab or more about soybean, tropical soybean, you can visit the website soybeaninnovationlab.illinois.edu or follow their Twitter handle at tropicalsoylab. And as B told me, the Twitter does not provide dating advice. It is more about soybean and science. So it is a good portal for this kind of information. Today's event focuses on the need of soybean practitioners to become successful developer for soybean. And as we all know, soybean is not a native crop for Africa. Practitioner farmers operating in the tropics. Soybean is commercial non-stable crop that is foreign to current agriculture portfolios in a small and medium holders. And during this workshop, we will learn more about tropical soybean for development, about some of the challenges, and about the problems that, and potential solution for them. Our first speaker is Dr. Rob Bertram, Chief Scientist, Bureau of Food Security at USAID. Please join us. Welcome, Dr. Bertram.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you, Ahmed. Okay, so I'm all set. And I'd like to begin by saying that besides that it's a pleasure to be here, that I really have what I'm going to say this morning. I got a lot of good support and ideas over the last year from Dr. Goldsmith, other colleagues in the lab, and from Dr. Kablan. And I have a number of slides that I cribbed from Pete. And I said to Pete, "Pete, I feel funny, you know, showing your slides." And he said, "No, that's okay. You're supposed to be the integrator here this morning." So I hope that my humility will shine through the fact that I'm using all these other people's work. So, but I want to, more seriously, I want to start out quickly. We have about 20 minutes, I think. I want to start out quickly with some context of why, you know, what's the context around this, the larger efforts that we're involved in Feed the Future. And then I think move on to the new ground of the Soybean Innovation Lab and why we're so excited about it. It's really a 21st century agricultural development program in many ways. And I hope that I can flag some of those for you. So this slide, if you look at that, there's nothing particularly new in terms of insights. In fact, I could have been standing here 10 years ago and shown you all these same points, and the world was doing very little. In fact, the world was busy disinvesting in agricultural development during that period, even though we knew this. And we knew, we had an evidence base to show what a good investment agricultural R&D is, and it still didn't change the situation in terms of the agriculture and food being on the back burner of the development agenda. So I think everybody by now knows what happened in 2007, 2008. Food once again became front page news. We saw civil unrest, disorder in maybe up to 30 countries. There was a lot of debate about what was causing this. Was it drought? Was it biofuels increasing demand? Was it policies around low stocks? And probably all of these were factors, but in a relatively small way. What we found instead is that we were in a new era of higher prices. This is not a spike. I mean, the prices have fluctuated still, but they're still well over what they had been in the early part of the last decade and in prior years. And we think there are two major factors. One is the demand shift that's associated with income growth, and particularly towards feed-intensive foods, so your animal source foods in particular, as incomes rise. So demand was racing ahead of population growth. But the second thing, which I think was less obvious to people, was the point that Ken Kaspin likes to make, that what we've had for the last 40 or so years is linear growth in our main commodities. So these are rice, wheat, and maize. In other words, the same increment year on year. But what that means is that what was almost a 3% growth rate in the 1960s is now just over 1%. And that declining rate of productivity growth undercuts a lot of the kinds of development gains that we saw in the early days of the Green Revolution in terms of keeping prices low. In fact, making prices, real prices, lower so that poor people had more money in their pockets every day. Because if you're spending 70% of your money on food, which is not uncommon, if food prices go down in a real sense, your disposable income increases. If the opposite occurs, which is what's happened in recent years, you get a big pinch, which is why we saw these riots break out as people saw their gains eroding rapidly. Now, the good news is that the way to deal with this is through R&D. In other words, we can up the curve there. We can push that curve up. And I would put forward to you that soy is a great case in point. Soy is a crop which has enjoyed continuing strong R&D. And I believe that the growth rate, Pete, you correct me if I'm wrong, is something over 2% with soy. So I mean, you can see very real differences associated with how much the global community is willing to invest in these critical food commodities. So just sort of summing up, this was a slide from Mark Rosegrant at IFPRI. We have these challenges, which we've also already mentioned there at the top, that can be driving the food price situation. We have critical natural resource challenges, and we have this issue of reinvesting in R&D, reversing years of disinvestment, and I think very importantly to feed the future and to the Soybean Innovation Lab is linking these changes, these investments in R&D and capacity building allied to that, to on the ground impact and helping really show that we can make that change and justify our way forward. So beginning in 2009, when he took office, the president launched the Feed the Future initiative as part of the G8. Feed the Future is an all-of-government effort, so USDA, Millennium Challenge Corporation, State Department, Peace Corps are all partners with us. And we are the $3 billion, that was for 3 years, a billion or so a year piece of a $22.5 billion G8 commitment that was made in L'Aquila in Italy. I wanted to flag two of these. One of them I have highlighted, three, because that's the R&D piece that I think is right at the heart of the work of the lab. But also take your attention to number six, which is about improved access to food and nutrition services. So this is the thrust of Feed the Future that is as much about nutrition and a nutrition enhancement as it is about growth, traditional growth from agricultural development. I want to say a little bit on the how. This is the what Feed the Future does. The how, a few points, country-led. That means if our partner countries don't think it's a priority and they're not investing in it, we probably shouldn't either. A second point is that we have three cross-cutting areas. One is gender, which again, critically important to the nutrition outcomes, but also as women are economic agents in the agricultural development process and leaders of all, throughout the set of expertises that are required. And then this approach on value chains, which is also very much the central focus for most of our mission programs overseas. And we have 19 focus missions. 12 of those are in sub-Saharan Africa. Finally, on this, the metrics for Feed the Future were very high level objectives. And it's very interesting because one is poverty reduction, which maybe isn't a surprise for those of us in ag research. The other is reduction in stunting in children under two, which is an enormous lift for those who are involved in agricultural R&D. And it speaks to the importance of making nutrition objectives absolutely in the center and outcomes absolutely in the center of the whole initiative. So what did we do on the research side? We basically overlay child stunting data with poverty data. And what we find out is that four geographies really pop out. And poverty and hunger, and this is sometimes counterintuitive, are concentrated in these bread baskets and rice bowls of the world. That's where the people are. That's where the poverty and hunger is. So we're not ignoring Latin America. We're not ignoring the Middle East. We have research programs in particular and policy programs that speak to those areas. We have focus countries in Central America. But the magnitude of the challenge in terms of both stunting and poverty is elsewhere that's dwarfed by the situation in sub-Saharan Africa and in South Asia in terms of the sheer numbers of people involved. So then with these four geographies, which overlap to a very good degree our focus countries, and you can see the in Africa we have the Ethiopian highlands, the eastern and southern Africa mixed maize based systems, and the Sudano-Sahelian zone across West Africa. Across these, we had three major themes emerge. One was traditional agricultural research, advancing the productivity frontier, you know, vaccines, breeding and genetics, genomics, the things that are really out there in terms of pushing that yield frontier. The second thing was the transforming key production systems. And that's this idea that if we're going to solve hunger and poverty, we've got to help smallholders in these major agricultural systems improve their livelihoods, their returns to land, labor, and capital. And the third is this nutrition and food safety. And soy, actually, I think, has a very key role to play in all three of those objectives. So at AID, then, we took those larger goals and thought about, well, what are our where should we make our investments? So we have three long-term investment areas: climate resilient cereals, advanced research on pests and diseases of plants and animals, and this is where we can leverage, say, science from the Danforth Center in St. Louis into cassava to combat brown streak in Africa, even though we don't have cassava programs. The third is this idea of really investing in legume productivity. And legume productivity is important for many reasons. I think the biggest driver was the fact that legumes have such an important food quality aspect. But they also have very attractive aspects economically and, of course, environmentally. Then we had three cross-cutting areas: the Safe and Nutritious Foods Program, again, reflecting back to, say, the legumes or possibly the livestock and the animal disease and that sort of thing. Policy and markets, institutional kinds of policy and market support, and analysis and research, and then the program for human and institutional capacity development. And I might mention that one of those programs is actually led by the University of Illinois. That's our modernizing extension and advisory services. And I see Suzanne Poland, who's the manager of that program. So we have those. And then they all come together in something we call sustainable intensification. And this is the idea that you deal with the natural resource issues, you deal with the human capacity, the policy, the market issues, and you integrate your component technologies, and that's what gives you the underpinning for a transformation of the system. And if you think about it, soy is absolutely critical in legumes. It's critical in the quality food and nutrition outcome, and it's critical, in my view, in the sustainable intensification because of the role it plays in increasing the fertility of systems. So then we went on and set up a whole series of new partnerships with universities, some of them built on the existing CRISP portfolio. Many of them are new. We have 24 altogether now, Feed the Future Innovation Labs, and more than 60 universities are partnering. These are all competitively bid programs. They feature multiple models of engagement, and one of those models is the consortium model, which is used here in the Soybean Innovation Lab. It's also particularly noteworthy in the Nutrition Innovation Lab, which is led out of Tufts University, which is also a consortium. So now I'm going to sort of zero in a little more on soy. So why soy? Why now? And this is where we start to really lean on Dr. Goldsmith and Dr. Kablan sitting over there, and thanks to both of them. I think you can see, maybe you've seen this kind of data before. I think it's the fourth point that is really key for us today, and in particular the fact that soy is an emerging crop in sub-Saharan Africa. And for my money, it's a very compelling element of a modernizing food system. It's right at the forefront of that. It's a new crop. It's a new crop in most of the world, of course, but it's a new crop in Africa. It is one of the ways that I think we can link rural production to emerging wealth in urban centers and in provincial centers. And I think this is the kind of thing that we're really excited to see to help look at agricultural transformation as part of a broader national growth strategy in our partner countries, and ultimately, very importantly, a source of jobs for the young people, some alternative to migrating to a city where the employment opportunities may be very limited. Now, the benefits of soybean are really manifold. I think the dietary transformation in terms of livestock and protein probably is our biggest driver. Having both this food and feed feature is a really unique aspect of soy, or at least among, I think, the legumes. The other thing that we see is, generally speaking, soy production is associated with positive outcomes in other aspects of livelihoods. And I think that's because of the value proposition of the crop. Low latitude systems are emerging, yet the research base to subtend those smallholder producers is still fairly weak. This is, IITA, Ken Daschle is here, which is a partner in this venture, is has been working on this for years, but the other sources of investment in soy in countries like Africa have been, in areas like Africa, have been relatively few and far between. Also, of course, the environmental advantages associated with soy are and biological nitrogen fixation are also very significant. So then the point of all this is, so this revolution is occurring. And I think for all of us, and maybe most of all for the lab, is how can smallholders participate in this emerging soy revolution? And you can see that right now we're starting at a very low base. I mean, the sub-Saharan Africa without South Africa is 0.5% of global production. And yet we know that it has the potential to be transformative. So we want to figure out how to see this coming soy revolution in Africa be smallholder friendly, if not actually smallholder driven, which is something I spoke with Louise Sperling a couple of weeks ago, and she wants it to be all about smallholders. I'll be happy if they have a role, but it'd be great to see them really emerge as key players. So of course the key driver is animal feed. And I should note that one of our other innovation labs, the Aquafish Lab, also works on soy-based fish feeds as an alternative to using fish meal. So it's very environmentally friendly, important, locally produced feeds. And we have a mission program in Nigeria, I believe, investing in that area. the emerging poultry and swine markets in sub-Saharan Africa, I think, will be the biggest driver. But we don't want to ignore food, of course, and that's one of the great benefits of working with our U.S. community, because we have a long history through, for example, programs like WISH and the National Soybean Research Lab that have been investing in how to make soy foods more and more available. And I keep hearing now that soy snack foods and such are emerging in countries around Africa, in West Africa, but also now in Malawi, and we hope to see that soon in Zambia and Mozambique as well. So in terms of the value chain approach, which matches our mission approach, you can see the four areas at the bottom that I think make for a solid program that is being emphasized by the lab. I would just point out that I think that the socioeconomic component is going to link all four of those areas, because you're going to have a feedback loop from post-harvest and utilization back to genetic improvement. And we can see here that they're talking about basically three areas in terms of production, improved household nutrition, and market linkages. And then an innovative approach through what's called the SMART, the Soybean Management with Appropriate Research and Technology Platform. And this is part of, I think, the larger capacity building and impact promoting aspect of the program. Here's a quick overview of where the program is working. It's driven in large part by our missions that we're investing in soy, often around the poultry industry. So that was in Ghana, in Malawi, in Mozambique, and I think it's also, you're working in Zambia as well, to some degree, Pete. So you can see we have that strong base. And then, of course, IITA is headquartered in Nigeria, so there really could be another point there in terms of the partnership that IITA is bringing. And just a quick overview of the breadth and depth of the program. It's brought in leading researchers from around the U.S. university community, the three main leads, Illinois, Missouri, and Mississippi State. And we're just delighted to see that kind of effort being brought together in an integrated single program to address the complex set of challenges that are facing soy. So this issue of smallholders. So I mentioned already the SMART, the collaboration with IITA. We're delighted to see this integration with CG programs. We see this across the innovation labs, but this one, it's hardwired, and we really appreciate that kind of mutually beneficial partnership that emerges. I think the innovative approach to building degree capacity amongst our African university partners is an exciting area. And also, just the food-focused effort on low-processed soy, which could be very important for enhanced production and value addition of soy-based foods. So here's a little bit more on the gaps that are being filled, all through a collaborative research approach that we're working on BNF. Seed quality is a huge issue in Africa, huge bottleneck everywhere, but particularly in soy, where there's a lot of issues around seed viability, especially in a tropical climate. The whole animal feed value chain, I think, is going to emerge as a very important opportunity, both for African producers and for American producers. And I'll say just a little bit more about that. And there'll be a substantial, in addition to the socioeconomics I mentioned, a substantial knowledge management component through the portal that's flagged there at the bottom. So just very briefly, I wanted to flag three areas of benefit to the U.S. community. And I do this because some of you know that for many years, AID really didn't get near soybean. There's some bad feelings about Brazil. I can't judge whether they were justified or not, but there was a low. We had this period in the 80s when prices were very depressed. And yet what we saw in recent years was the American Soybean Association out there promoting soy utilization, but also starting to work in soy production as well in places like Afghanistan and elsewhere. And we had discussions with WISH and with the ASA, and we got the sense that people realized that fostering the market demand for soy had really been the transformative factor that put soybean prices up and established soy as the go-to food, feed, oil source crop for much of the world's food systems, and that that happening in Africa was also going to benefit U.S. soy growers. We are science-based. U.S. science, U.S. collaboration, I think, helps raise awareness of how modern science can be leveraged to address challenging problems facing smallholder farmers. And we have a lot of programs in plant biotechnology and in capacity development about science-based regulatory systems. I think the kinds of collaborations with U.S. Institutions like those involved in the Innovation Lab can only benefit better understanding and awareness of the potential of these new approaches. And finally, and very importantly, these U.S. industry standards being understood and hopefully accepted broadly, that will, in the long run, make Africa an important market for U.S. soy and much better positioned to import whole beans, which is where our competitive advantage lies. So we really see this, just as we do many of our innovation labs, as a win-win proposition. So those are my thoughts. It's again, it's very exciting to be here. Big thanks to Pete and the whole team, and Ahmed and Hailu and Vern on our side, but also all of the professors and researchers across the three lead universities and the African partners involved in IITA as well. So thanks very much, and over back to you, Ahmed.
Thank you, Rob. We will have about 19 minutes for Q&A. We will have questions from the room and questions from online from the webinar. Start with the room. Questions?
Hi, I'm Karen Edwards with the American Soybean Association's World Initiative for Soy and Human Health. And my question is, thank you for your presentation today, and wondered if you could elaborate on the potential for knowledge sharing between the different innovation labs, and in particular connection with the nutrition work that Tufts is doing, because as you referenced, soy has a lot of nutritional benefits.
Thank you, Karen. Yes, I'll tell you that that nutrition lab is in hot demand. And by our missions, who, as you can imagine, are also very much grappling with how to make agricultural investments friendlier to nutrition outcomes. And we do have, we have a program emerging in Cambodia and Bangladesh, a couple of missions involved, as well as ourselves from the Bureau for Food Security, that links together the Innovation Lab, Hort Lab, the IPM Lab, hopefully the Aquafish Lab, World Fish, the Asian Vegetable Research and Development Center, and SIP, to look at horticulture and aquaculture within rice-based systems. And the Nutrition Lab is leading that effort. And it's really about figuring out how to make these technologies nutrition drivers and nutrition friendly. I know we can do a lot more than that. We do foster collaboration, communication across the labs. We have we just had a meeting of all the innovation labs in Washington last month. That involved many visits to the Hill as well, which were very exciting for the staff members that we met with. And that wasn't just in the foreign relations side. The Agriculture Committee was really excited about this too. So it's still early days, but we do want to foster collaborative approaches. And let me just ask if any of my colleagues want to take a stab at the elaborating on this. Carol Levin, please, who is the force behind many of the Innovation Lab efforts.
I just wanted to say, during the September meeting that Rob referenced, a steering committee was formed of the 24 Innovation Labs to actually look at specific ways to increase collaboration between the Innovation Labs. So they're going to be looking at ways
to. So that's an agenda item.
Yes. Great.
And just on the knowledge sharing component, I also just wanted to mention that the Bureau for Food Security has a knowledge sharing mechanism called the Knowledge-Driven Agricultural Development Mechanism. And the AgriLinks, the AgriLinks platform, which is doing a lot of work to help connect and foster knowledge sharing between the innovation labs and do some capture, like at this event, and try and bring in external partners to kind of get that information. So there's a lot of talk about it, but still a lot of progress to be made.
Thank you, Julie. And I will take this chance also to thank our AgriLink Runner or KDAD team who are helping us in the technical support and they helped the organizing this workshop. Thank you. Question from webinar?
We do. We have one question from the webinar from Lloyd LePage, who is joining us from Iowa. We have about 50 people online and an active conversation going on in the chat pod. So this is a question for Rob. How are you, and by you I assume he means USAID, providing support to emerging African seed companies on foundation and breeder seed access to tropical soy? And I think specifically he means technical support.
Okay, it's an incredibly important area, and I would say it's a bottleneck, frankly, the issue of foundation seed. And I think Pete could answer this better than I, but the challenges in soy are among the most significant because of the need for high quality seed, the perishability in terms of germination viability and so forth. We are investing in this area in part through our collaboration with AGRA, also through regional programs with our missions, but it's an area we need to do more in. We've just are beginning a collaboration with the World Bank and the Gates Foundation that looks at, again, how can we try to address this gap around foundation seed. So it's a work in progress, but let me ask if Ken or Pete or anybody who is better able to capture where this stands with respect to soy.
Yeah, I'd comment, but I think there's probably someone like Dennis or Randy, Brian, Dan. Do you have something you want to throw in on seeds? Throwing it back to me. Yeah, good. Yeah, this issue is important across a number of levels, certainly on the regulatory certification, the quality control, the whole seed system. And so the seed scaling issue is one that we're very much involved with and thinking about how to move seed, high quality seed that will germinate, known seed that you know what maturity zone, period, to performance, and so forth. And this is a very difficult task. Also, soy is a varietal, so it's can be saved. So private sector involvement is very necessary, but of interest or a challenge because of seed saving. So this is a big issue. Soy seed itself is delicate. It's a thin seed coat. So preserving seed over wintering is a challenge in low latitude tropical settings. So there are a number of issues somewhat unique to soy that we face, and hence a big mandate for the innovation lab and the research team at the lab.
Hi, University of Illinois, Earl Kellogg. Really appreciate this overview, Rob. I think the Feed the Future and the strategy is excellent and good to see this fleshed out. One of the things I think we all realize is that the long-term sustainability of all of these is going to rest on human and institutional capacity development. And we got lots of breeders and lots of agricultural economists and lots of seed specialists, et cetera, et cetera. I'm wondering how not only the Soybean Innovation Lab, but how USAID is thinking about people who are much more expert in the question of human and institutional capacity development, collaborating with the more technical folks and in these programs. I think it's really an important, we sometimes leave them out.
Yeah. That's a good observation, Earl, and I think we're partway there. We have in the Office of Agriculture Research and Policy, we have a human and institutional capacity development group who are closely tied to the R&D investments. And what we see through our innovation labs is a whole array of investments, sometimes with the same institutions in the same country, but we haven't figured out how to translate those, you know, necessarily to be intentional about making the whole greater than the sum of the parts in terms of the institutional outcomes. We're thinking hard about this, and ultimately what I'd like to see is a strategy emerge that's going to require people of the type you mentioned, the people that really get the part about capacity development of institutions. And we have real leaders in this area in the office, but also outside in the community working with us to put together a strategy that for a reasonable amount of investment really gets at some of the institutional issues. I don't think we're going back to the days 30 years ago when we had huge bilateral projects focused on institution building. We have a few, and I'm delighted we have those, one in Tanzania led by Ohio State, involving a number of other universities. But I think we are going to be able to look at investments like the Soy Innovation Lab and make the case to the mission in Ghana or Mozambique that, you know, if we do this little add-on, we can really start to get at some of those more systemic issues, at least for that crop, and at least to build that sustainability. I also want to give big kudos to the lab for its innovative approach on capacity building through alliance with the university in Legon, elsewhere. Again, this is a new experiment, a new model of leveraging U.S. capacity to build the African capacity building capacity. So I, you know, the jury's out. I think you know Susan. You've helped us think some of these things through, I know, Earl. But Susan Owens, Clara Cohen, Shauna Gillette, Karen Duca, we've got a great team thinking about this. And they are leveraging the thoughts of people across our bureau and in the innovation labs. But, you know, we're open to ideas. We really want to get at that, especially in a way that our missions will join with us.
Ken Dashiel, excuse me, IITA in Nigeria. Just a comment on the seeds and foundation seed, breeder seed. It is a huge challenge. There are some big successes in Africa with private seed companies such as Seedco, which is based in Zimbabwe. Excellent program for at least 45 years. And they have been historically mainly linked with large-scale farmers, but they're transitioning now and really putting a big effort to work with the small-scale farmers. Also, in West Africa, there's not so much of a history of private enterprise and seed companies, although that is changing quickly in Nigeria. In fact, there's over 100 seed companies there now. They have the same problem. And so in response to that, IITA has started what is called the Go Seed. It's basically a private seed company, which focuses on breeder seed and foundation seed. So when the private company says we need breeder seed, historically we'd say, oh, no problem, here's 3 kilograms for you. Now we say, no problem, here's 1 ton for you. So my comment then is a question. With one of the high goals of USAID being poverty alleviation, I'm wondering if you have any special emphasis on looking at youth and bringing youth out of poverty and giving them opportunities for jobs so that they don't get distracted by some of the negative influences we have around the world.
Yeah. Thanks for the comment, Ken, and also for the question. Yes, it's a priority for our administration, right up to the president. YALI is the Young African Leaders Initiative. We see a lot of discussion of the youth bulge. You know, many of the countries that we're working in have a very different population curve in terms of age, with a very large bulge at this young generation. So yes, we are. And the challenge, I think, is linking to that area of investment and endeavor. We need to do more thinking about that in terms of, you know, the employment generation piece. But soy, with all its value addition components is probably one of the best places to be thinking about that.
Hey, Rob, thank you very much. I'm John Corbett from Aware. It's interesting that as I listened this morning, this incredible energy building around this term innovation and 24 innovation labs, and then this youth bulge, the population challenges. And it seems to me that there's just an element, you just said you need to continue to think about it. There's an element there in my observation, and then my question to you is, it seems like entrepreneurship is actually something that there's skills and knowledge and entrepreneurship all over, and the United States is particularly good at that, as you know. But it seems like, and I went to an Ag Innovation Showcase in St. Louis in September and was really struck by the phenomenal innovation coming in agriculture, and perhaps part of the solution to this challenge of moving this innovation into the African context would come from nurturing entrepreneurship, because it does need to be nurtured. Maybe some comments on that?
Yes, we have a slide we use that shows the strategy in Feed the Future for, we have research, policy and data analysis, education, extension, and we have entrepreneurship there. It's probably the area that our side, the R&D policy science side, invests the least in. We have another partner office in the Bureau, which is Markets Partnership and Innovation, and they do think more about that. But I absolutely agree, John, and part of what we're trying to do is make agriculture a good investment. For on-farm, for smallholders, but also off-farm. So here's where you get to transparency in markets, reasonable trade regimes that allow trucks to move through borders without sitting for 3 days, all sorts of things along the way that are going to enhance the transparency and predictability of what a private investor is going to encounter if he or she decides to invest. The rub in our, for example, in the new alliance, which is under the G8 or now G7, is very much through partnerships with the private sector. And there's a bit of a quid pro quo here in terms of policy changes in the partner countries. There's a great desire to have all levels of companies participate in that. So while we have DuPont, Pioneer, and we have perhaps Unilever and others, I don't know them all. We're also looking for smaller companies in the countries in which we're working, or regionally based companies. And I think we're having some success there, but I know that it's an area where we'd love to see more happen. We'd love, and maybe, as you suggest, thinking about how to leverage the knowledge and skills of our agricultural entrepreneurial community and our food systems community, broadly speaking, would be something we could think about. It's certainly, we do agree with you, it's an issue.
So Craig Gunderson from University of Illinois, and I wanted to briefly come back to Karen's comment about the Nutrition Innovation Lab. With the Soybean Innovation Lab, are collaborating and plans to collaborate in several ways with this Nutrition Innovation Lab. Pete and I both have been to Boston to meet with the people there at Tufts. One particular area is they have a soy-based weaning food that they are testing out in, I believe, Uganda and then in Ghana, and we're talking about working with them along those lines. So we see these innovation labs as an exciting way to collaborate across different dimensions.
Great, that's great.
Thank you.
Know.
One last question.
Somebody online maybe, huh?
On the line.
So we have a question from James Hershey in Kansas City, Missouri. He works with the American Soybean Association's WISH program. And Rob, he was asking pragmatically, how do implementing partners connect the dots in this whole of government approach, specifically connecting Soy Innovation Lab to programs such as McGovern Dole and Food for Progress?
Oh, well, I'm thinking that Jim might be able to answer that better than I. He's probably got more ideas than I do. But I think it's just the kind of thing we'd like. Let's say, take groundnut, for example, and this whole issue of ready-to-use therapeutic foods. That's an area where we have done work over time to try to connect what we're doing on the food innovation side of groundnuts, where, again, quality control is very important. You know, think of aflatoxin in particular. but also the potential benefits for because of the dense nutrient content of groundnut. Another case in point is where we have done some work in Ethiopia on chickpea. And the idea there was to develop chickpea smallholder linkages to chickpea markets, both for snack foods, nutritious snack foods, I should add, but also to World Food Program purchases and again, preparation of RUTFs for people in serious undernutrition circumstances. I think it'd be great if we could somehow figure out how to make that connection. And again, I'm getting into areas I don't really know the bigger piece of, but if you think about some aspects of food aid reform and the interest in local purchase, if there was a way to also connect some aspects of the Soy Innovation Lab, either through processing and local value addition or through integrating, you know, the knowledge around post-harvest handling and moving product to the preparation and provision of soy-based foods in school feeding programs, I think it'd be very exciting. But I bet there's others in the room who either have more insight on this or else we could look to partners in our Food for Peace Bureau and also in colleagues with USDA to comment on that, Jim. But, you know, thanks for that question. And that's several of the questions that you've heard this morning are really things that going forward, there's probably a lot of potential to really plumb them.
Thank you, Rob.
My pleasure.
Just as a
put on my Soybean Innovation Lab hat on just for a second. First, I want to thank someone, our project manager, Courtney Tamimi, for arranging, doing anything you see, especially of quality. Courtney did, okay? Anything that, you know, if there's like a name tag that looks like that was me. So she, just an amazing person, and we thank so much for her. I want to welcome you all and welcome those on the web as well. We're excited to be here. I'm going to take off that Soybean Innovation Lab hat, director hat off, and really just talk about its area that's certainly core to my research program, the economics of tropical soybean. So we'll spend a little bit of time on this, and I think it's important because tropical soybean production, the production economics, differs quite significantly from a temperate or high latitude, maybe call it medium latitude, soybean production common in the Midwest, U.S., and Argentina, for example. I didn't realize I wouldn't be able to see the slide, four walkaway messages. One of them is how important it is to think of and understand the implications of soy as a non-native, non-staple commercial crop. Okay, we might hear these terms, but these are profoundly impactful on the adoption question, the household implications, gender question, and so forth. So it's very much, so that's a walk away. A second walk away is that we do know and are very confident about soy being a highly productive protein and oil crop adapted for the tropics. And protein as a scarce macronutrient in the tropics, most crops are starch crops. This is quite unique and can have profound implications. As Rob mentioned nicely about the economic impact, and we'll talk a little bit about spillovers and soy as part of a system that's an economic engine for rural development. The third point is that I led off with about the economics being quite different, okay? And really compare and contrast, and we'll get into that a little bit more when we compare to temperate soybean economics. And finally is the point about the need for research, the need to understand this non-staple commercial crop in this new environment of a tropical setting and as a development crop. Before we rush to scale up, we need to understand some very, very basic concepts. And that really was the cool thing behind the USAID issuing an RFP, recognizing the importance of getting a research foundation established for the practitioners, the implementing partners, the consultancies and private sector as they start to scale up and really get on board this soybean revolution. The economics of soybean is a very broad topic, and I'm only in my area of research is just a teeny weeny little corner of this, so I'm not going to talk about the economics associated with value chains. And Rob mentioned how important as a commercial crop this is significant implications. Same for seed supply chains, a very, very important area, non-trivial challenge to bringing high-quality seed and getting high-quality seed in the hands of farmers. It's a long supply chain. It's an arduous supply chain. And so that's the economics of that are quite important. Another area of research and importance in which, again, I won't talk about at all, is really soy within this economic development context tied in with the feed industry, input supply, tremendous spillovers, okay? The human development indices where we see tropical soy being produced now are extremely high, okay? So the mapping of soy and human development So the indicators are quite positive. And then an area that's the domain of a colleague of mine, Jill Findice at University of Missouri, about household adoption in soy and how soy fits into the household portfolio of production crops. This is immensely important for development. Again, that's something that Jill can speak to much better than I can. And then gender that Rob talked about as a priority area. Soy and women-led households, women's decision-making, and how that interacts with the soy production and those decisions. And our colleagues, Kathleen Ragsdale and Lindsay Peterson at Mississippi State, head up a large project looking at the relationship between soy and gender. Finally, policy and competitiveness. This is a large area on the effect on prices, import substitution, and more of the macroeconomics of soy. Again, an area. My area is really on the business side, on the production economics. And so I'm going to talk really about the production function, how soy is grown in the tropics, low tech versus high tech, the role of scale economies, something very important in the development context. Has huge welfare implications, and then the cost of production, which has great importance. Soy is the fastest growing crop in the world. This is indexed on the year 2000, and soy is that gold line here at the top at about 3% a year since 2000, about 25% faster growth than the second crop canola, and about a third faster than the third crop maize. So this is a very high growth crop, and producers are meeting the demand, and production is ramping up. The question, of course, is who? That's the development question. Who's going to produce this? The demand is there. As you can see, most of the high growth crops are starch crops, and so soy has a nice position, a niche to fill. Okay, Rob showed this earlier, the importance of this. You're talking about $126 billion going to farmers worldwide, and it's growing at 3%. Okay, Less than 0.5% goes to sub-Saharan African farmers, kind of the target for Feed the Future. And the question is, will they participate? And if yes, how? And that's a major question, and it's a non-trivial question, okay? Because it's not straightforward, okay? We see some of the linkage between poultry and soy. It's very tight. In general, in certain countries, you see poultry, a compound annual growth rate on the first column, and then the soybean growth rate for that country. You look at a country like South Africa, which is a large exporter of soy, has both very high soy growth rates and high poultry growth rates. You see the lower three countries. Again, this is to 2011. So this is a very recent phenomenon, these kinds of growth. The rise of production, for example, in Mozambique hasn't even hit the FAO data set yet, but it will. But you see that poultry growth is far outstripping soy. That means in the case of Ghana, for example, lots of imports of soy. So this is just showing a very dynamic marketplace right now, very exciting place to be. So soy is a non-native. We want to specify, and the implication for that is that there's very little experience in the agricultural system. That means among agronomists, among plant breeders, among processors, food manufacturers, feeders, formal feeds. For a lot of people, this is a new thing. This is a new thing, okay? For example, Syngenta did this very cool study from 2009-2012 across six countries, had 10,000 observations of farmers of how they acquire their seeds. Where are they getting, what's the nature of the seed system that supports these farmers? They looked at 32 crops, okay? None of them were soy. It's just new. It's just new out there, and we have to be humbled by its newness, that we can't be cavalier here, okay? And this is similar. We're doing, have a curated database of soybean research across all of sub-Saharan Africa, looking at the National Ag Research Database, IITA's great database on research. And when you look at, say, in Ghana, for example, 1/10 of the scientific publications, 10%, the amount of soybean versus cowpea, for example. It's just been that we have different priorities and historically different priorities. The soy revolution means we need to get on board if the sub-Saharan Africa is going to participate. As a non-staple, this is very important about, in this case, I'm just highlighting the role of women. This is a neat study done in Zambia by ACD Ivoca in 2012. And they looked across six crops and five functions and said, is this male determined or driven or female decided? And indexed on ground nuts, in terms of women-led decision-making, and it's about 17%. So it's much less in their survey, women-led in soybean. And that has huge implications for the household, adoption, the nutrition components, and so forth. So gender is a major issue. And we think of, at the household level, labor as a scarce resource. We often think of there's lots of labor, but there isn't. There's competing uses. There's women are being asked to do a lot of things, and can they incorporate soy in their portfolio? Now let's get at a little bit about the technology and the production function and the economics of soy. There haven't been a lot of studies on the actual microeconomics of what farmers actually do when they plant soy in a developing country setting. There have been three studies, okay? One in Ghana on the left, two regions in Sobota and Chirponi Another study that was done in Ghana kind of nationally, and then the Tanzania study. And these are surveys of actual farmers and farmer practices and so forth. And when you look at the inputs that the farmers are using, the little blue area, this little sliver up here, it reflects the inputs. So this would be inoculum, soil correction, fertilizer, fungicide, any other pesticide, insecticide, and so forth. The big brown area in terms of inputs, and this is a major area of kind of academic research about valuing labor, is labor. And so you're looking among these researchers, you're looking between 70 and 80% of the cost of producing soy being labor among these smallholder environments, this low-tech approach, okay? And then you've got these other costs are this red, and then this purple over here would be fixed costs. This would be land, depreciation on equipment, things like that. So this is the takeaway here, that this is a low technology system, not surprisingly, very labor intensive, okay, with very few inputs. Okay, so this is a low technology tropical, you could call production function. Now, we've done a lot of work in Brazil, in the low-lat soybean region of Brazil, in the state of Mato Grosso, Brazil, and this would be classified as a high-technology tropical soybean. So same, you can think of the exact or similar latitude, similar soil, similar germplasm or potential germplasm, but the production function looks quite different. Here, labor is quite small, as you can imagine. And then you've got this big chunk, 50% on inputs. And these inputs, they do not really include seed as a minor component, okay? So the seed cost for the farmers in Mato Grosso is not very high, especially relative to what producers in the Midwest US pay. This is for inoculum. This is for soil correction. This is for pesticides, okay? So it's a input intensive in a tropical setting. It's input intensive for these producers. The previous producers, you're looking at yields less than 1,000 kilos per hectare. Here you're looking at 3,000 kilos per hectare in this setting, okay? And more capital intensive, obviously equipment, and land. And then finally, do I have it? Temperate, yeah. We go to the US in the Midwest where I'm from in Illinois. Here again, similar to the high tech tropical, low labor input, very high fixed cost, high land, high capital cost. Different from the high tech tropical, and inputs, this is mostly seed, very low input. Soybean for us in the Midwest is a low input crop, not a high input crop like in the tropics. So that production function is quite different for the high-tech tropical producer compared to the low-tech. Okay, we can look at some costs, okay? And just looking at the costs across these studies, and you see the Mato Grosso study, second from the right, and Midwest U.S. far to the right, these show up at dramatically different sets of inputs. And one would imagine with dramatically different sets of inputs, you might get or likely get dramatically different sets of outputs and dramatically different sets of levels of profitability. Okay. Interestingly, and this is very important within the value chain context, people want to know about price. Are the markets clearing? Are the markets thick for selling soybean in a developing country setting? What I have here is the price per ton reported by the researchers, $500 US dollars per ton, metric ton in Ghana, for example, is about 98% of the Chicago mercantile cash for that year. It's a strong basis. The demand for soy is there. It's not about selling the crop. It's about producing the crop that's the challenge. We look at profitability. It's depending on how you value labor, it gets to be, it can move around quite a bit. But the high tech, and I point over to the Mato Grosso data, about $175 per hectare net. Okay. There have been several studies that compare low-tech and high-tech rice, low-tech in Burkina, low-tech and high-tech cotton, low-tech and high-tech maize, and low-tech and high-tech soybean. The results are probably not surprising. They're just huge differences on technology. So this is a question to wrestle with about the role of high technology, of technology in soy for development. All the studies seem to be consistent, and in terms of the net and the difference when you add technology in there. We're not talking about biotechnology, we're just talking about inputs, okay? So finally, let me summarize. So for this non-native, non-staple commercial crop, clearly tropical soybean production can be a profitable enterprise. Demand is strong. We've surveyed, we know they can buy, we're working in northern Ghana, the demand for the soy that the farmers produce is there, very strong. The soybean human development indices too can be quite high because you have a very strong value chain with spillovers. You have soybean production, you have inputs, you have transport, you have feed, the feed industry, you have livestock, you have meat production, you have food production, all within the same value chain. And I mean, in certain settings, you even have bioenergy. And the question is really we're working on is how sustainable is low input soybean versus high input? And or is there something in between? We don't have a lot of research on this. We don't really understand. And what are the implications? And we're very concerned, certainly the social scientists, on the welfare implications. You know, what are the outcomes on livelihoods, poverty rates, and so forth? And it also raises a larger question about labor productivity, about that marginal unit of labor that the woman-led, the woman in the household when she plants a soybean versus a cassava or cowpea or something else. And that is quite an interesting question about becoming more productive to emerge from poverty. How do you make labor more productive? And does soy fit into that? Does soy fit into that? So those are my comments, and I look forward to some questions and discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Pete. We have 20 minutes for questions. We have a question online.
This question is from Dick Tinsley, who is joining us from Colorado. And getting to the points that you were making about labor, he was wondering, when soy is produced by smallholders, will it represent additional area cultivated or a substitution for a crop already being produced? And if it is a substitution, what will it substitute for? And how will that impact the economic analysis?
Right. Yeah, Dick, that's a very good question. And the short answer is I really don't know. And I think we wonder. And I want to, I know you guys, Jill and Lindsay are here. Do you have some thoughts on Dick's very, very important question? If we can get you a microphone, if you have some. Yeah, hold up. We got to get you on the mic. Say who you are, Lindsay.
Thanks. Lindsay Peterson, Mississippi State University. Kathleen and I, my co-PI, who is not here today, we did probably 12 or 13 focus groups with farmers in March of this year before we did a large-scale household survey in May and June. I would say just from informally in my brain analyzing the results of our focus groups that it will be a substitution effect, not an additional crop planted. But Jill, do you want to?
Jill Findeis, University of Missouri. I was going to say as well, I mean, we're doing this large survey across both Mozambique and Ghana right now. And we're hearing in the field in some places that there won't be a substitution. That's in Mozambique and Ghana is a different situation, but we will know. And I think that's the important, we should know early in spring what happens there. Okay.
Yeah.
Based on our experience in Mozambique, it's both. In other words, some people use it.
Jake, say who you are.
Jake Walter, TechnoServe in Mozambique. We've done a lot of work with soybeans over the years, and we've seen it go from a very minimally grown crop to 37,000 producers now, mostly smallholders. But the average size of farm is increasing. So there seems to be mechanization, and both on the threshing side and the land preparation side, that's increasing, it's doing some labor substitution, as well as hiring more labor. So people are using various ways to cultivate more land, but also some are staying at the same size and growing some soybeans, so there is some substitution.
Thanks, Peter, for the presentation. I'm Alpha from IIT, I'm based in Nigeria. If you are to do the study in Nigeria, you may get a different picture of soybean in West Africa, because the soybean production is more widespread in Nigeria, and then the value chain is stronger. What I'm seeing there, compared to Ghana, Ghana is really low tech, no use of input like fertilizer. But if you come to Nigeria, they are using a lot of input. The soils are very powerful for soybean production in West Africa. Low P, all of them across the savannas, including Ghana. So you cannot sustain soybean production in the long run without additional input. And this is really coming down to the smallholder farmers in Nigeria, and they always ask for fertilizer, or phosphorus, or NPK, and the government is supporting soybean production so that more people will grow. And the very interesting, more women are showing interest in growing soybean, particularly in the Guinea savannas of Nigeria. And what we lack maybe is a study of this type. So if they are doing the studies in Ghana or Mozambique, maybe we may need to collaborate with IIT to perhaps do a study of this kind in Nigeria for you to be able to compare countries in Africa who are using midwave, high tech, and those really doing low tech. It'll be very important for us.
Yeah, super comment. Can I ask you a question? Because it'd be great. Can you share a little bit about credit or how the farmers access the inputs? Are there lots of suppliers of inputs? Do they have access to credit?
It's not much about credit. The soybean processing system in Nigeria is more organized. A lot of the drivers are put to industry and the oil processors. Now in Nigeria, there are many oil processors processing soybean for poultry feed, for also for oil. And because of the middle class, everybody wants to be eating healthy oil. So they are driving the process of creating the demand for soybean production. And that demand a little bit higher than the other countries, and more people are going to soybean production. Then there's really good market for compound fertilizer and NPK. But what they need is phosphorus. So very few companies are selling also phosphorus fertilizer. For seed, as Ken said, it's a little bit a problem. Farmers are still using their own safe seed, and we see a lot of problem of germination and contamination, physical contamination. So now with the agri programs, the national systems, the government policy of liberating foundation seed production, before it was in the hands of government agencies. Now some seed companies are allowed to produce foundation seed for their own use, and there's some national systems. But still there's a problem because it is not like maize hybrid. So most seed companies prefer the maize to produce maize, not legumes. So most of the external programs that we are having is to support, really kickstart the support for foundation seed production. so that we can make that available to certify the seed companies and also encourage them to sell seed to the farmers.
A question from the webinar. This is from Lloyd LePage in Iowa. He works with Heartland Global Incorporated. And his question was, how can we create improved livestock feed demand and logistics to address filling the demand for smallholders?
Yeah, that's another very good question. You know, and we've been looking at particularly the poultry sector in Ghana, and I know Jake's going to talk about poultry in Mozambique, and as the gentleman said, related in Nigeria as well. I mean, the demand side, that pull is essential. And the organization of poultry production and the movement of capital to poultry production is a more feasible, reasonable process than capital moving to soybean production. It's for a number of reasons, technological reasons and intensification reasons, use of capital, there are a number of reasons. So that's makes the poultry pull more feasible, but also essential. And so in that level of activity and getting the poultry producers organized, getting them to, I wish our colleague Mike Lacey was here from University of Georgia, thinking about nutrition, switching poultry producers to formal feeds, local poultry, there's a lot of local poultry production as well, smaller scale, using formal feeds and higher quality proteins like soy. These create tremendous local demand and engaging small and medium holders. But a dynamic poultry sector and a poultry sector that is thinking in terms of formal feeds, engaged with the feed industry, modern rations and so forth becomes essential.
Thanks, Ahmed. Rob Bertram, Bureau for Food Security. I just wanted to share two comments, the first purely anecdotal, the second less so. A couple of years ago, when we were just starting out in this endeavor, I spoke with John Edgar, who some of you may know, he's the lead of our Feed the Future team in Malawi. And John told me something that I really was music to my ears. And that was that if a farmer in Malawi had a bag of soy, he or she could sell it. In other words, the market was going to make its way to them. Now that was very interesting to hear that, and I just mention it now in reference to the last question. More recently, though, and perhaps more significantly, Tom Jane, who some of you may know from Michigan State University, has been talking about, if not yet documenting, what he perceives as a real revolution in African agriculture in terms of market penetration. And we need to zero in on this, and our policy people are thinking about it, and Tom's been to the Bureau, three times, I think, in the last few months. But I think that we can think about information flows, particularly cell phones, in terms of exchanging information, infrastructure continuing to incrementally improve, and perhaps most importantly, particularly for this particular endeavor, the growth of wealth and the shift in diets associated with that in cities in particular. So, it's an exciting time. And I think you all are going to be at the forefront of understanding the dynamics of how these things come to bear on an emerging crop like soy.
Thank you.
Another question from the webinar. This one is from Surendra. And the question is, can Dr. Goldsmith, can you share some of your experiences or findings in terms of how seed is managed in soybean innovation lab countries where you're working? And a second question is, or is access to improved seed a factor in the rate of adoption?
Yeah. No, it's a significant constraint. And we also have good experience from Brazil on how they generated germplasm for the low-latitude tropical producers, really a focused effort not that long ago in the mid-1990s became quite aggressive. And the management and the investment is absolutely essential. Soy is very sensitive to photoperiods, to the latitude, to soils and pest pressures and so forth. So adapted seed is critical. So you start there. When you look at the system, and I probably should have Ken give his not that long, but a substantial history and relationship with producing soy germplasm and sending it through the system, working with the National Ag Research organizations at the various countries. There's a tight relationship between IITA and the NARS, the National Ag Research System, and this is very, very important. IITA has brought a lot of germplasm in from the U.S. And Brazil over the years, developed their own and worked very closely, and every year send out large quantities of breeder seed out for development among the NARS. The NARS breeders themselves are very active trying to advance to develop adapted varieties, and also this filters through to the private sector. We had a very interesting meeting down in Lusaka with the private sector and public sector, all the major soybean breeders in Zambia. And it was very interesting that the struggle with access to high quality breeder seed and getting, increasing that turnover, because it's a numbers game. You need large volumes. And so that system from IITA and the National Ag Research System, as well as the partnership with the private sector, becomes very, very essential. But basic questions about seed labs, seed storage, maintaining germination, profitability for the private sector so that they'll invest in soy, these still remain. So these are basic questions that the breeders have access to the technology to store the seed, to test the seed, to understand and differentiate one seed from another. Very important issue that Hailu and I've talked about, very, very important, about varietal testing and the transparency about one variety versus another. This is a very important feature of a successful seed system. So it's a large problem, a very essential problem to tropical soybean development.
Great. Another question from the webinar. Lots of questions coming in. This one is from Subramanayam, and apologies if I'm mispronouncing your name. And the question is, similar to the Brazilian context, does the Soybean Innovation Lab look at the African situation, specifically in the change from subsistence smallholder farmers to large-scale farmers?
Yeah. The process, clearly there's a difference. And it comes down, certainly the access to land is quite different in the African context to the situation I'm familiar with in Mato Grosso, in Brazil. And so that's a big difference. The situation in Mato Grosso was a very called organic process. It was one where the farmers had access to land, and they determined what the appropriate scale, technology, and so forth, and went forth. They did not have government assistance. They had access to land, and essentially that was it. They don't have infrastructure. So it's a very organic process. But the access to land was certainly fundamental. The adoption of technology is also quite important. So that experience, and I think it's quite telling, because the tropical environment is so hostile. And so somehow smallholders to be able to be competitive do need access, as the gentleman from IITA was saying earlier, access to technologies so that they can compete. It does seem to be, those seem to be the two major lessons that we can, when we compare and contrast the Brazilian and the Sub-Saharan African situation.
Hello, I'm Tola Nimibandi from Michigan State University. I was just wondering, I'm originally from Sri Lanka, and I was wondering whether you've ever considered soybean as a human food, because in where I come from, we have textured vegetable protein that is very, very popular. And I know, I don't know, but in the U.S. they have edamame, there are edamame snacks. So I was wondering if that was something that anybody has looked into.
Yeah, we have a number of experts, much more expert in this than I here in the room, and they can certainly chime in as well. Yeah, so soy for human food is of great interest and has been a very active area of research. You know, at the National Soybean Research Laboratory, University of Illinois, other places as well. The usage of soy, certainly in South Asia and in Southeast Asia, for human use, you know, much more prevalent and common in culture than in Africa and in Latin America and in Central America. But there are some great examples of soy for human use. The implementation of vitigoats, soy cows for soy products, soy entrepreneurship. So there are many, many examples out there of successful usage. So within the Soybean Innovation Lab, Craig Gunderson and Marilyn Nash, oh, there's Marilyn, there are the PIs on soy for human nutrition. So I'd let them add anything they want to add.
Hi, this is Marilyn Nash with the University of Illinois National Soybean Research Lab. And yes, part of the managed research area 5, I think it is, within SIL, we will be looking at how soy cows can make soy milk and foster community and enterprise development. And we will be working within the home-based processing systems to see if we can teach people in the communities how to process soy into either soy milk, soy flours, and using whole cooked soybeans in their daily meals. We'll be tracking that to see how well they can adopt those techniques and technologies.
One last question. Tom Shaw from CRS. Actually, it's not so much a question as a comment. In northern Benin, we have a home industry with a lot of our savings groups of making soy cheese, which is tofu. And actually, it's a huge money making. Most of the ladies can earn as much as $300 a year simply on the, net benefit of $300 a year simply by soy food, and it's in all the markets. I don't know how much you people travel, but I travel a lot. And a lot of the meat in the markets, I really wonder what it is and how long it's been there. So I'm a firm supporter of all of these ladies with little industries of buying the cheese because it's deep fried, which isn't the greatest way to do it, but it still is very tasty and spicy. And then I don't have to worry about the protein source that I'm eating when I'm up there. And I know it's not in your project, but since I've been asked to look at this, I've been kind of wondering why not. The region in northern Ghana you're looking at is very, very similar in terms of what they eat and what they do is in northern Benin. And we didn't do this. CRS introduced soy about 20 years ago and was for feed or something like that. But that isn't where the industry went. The industry has gone to tofu. And, they just call it cheese. And it's really amazing that you see these vast pots that are almost the size of this table in villages, cooking it up and fermenting it the whole time, and they sell it every fifth day. There's a market every fifth day in the area. It's just an incredible source of both protein, because people consume it, and an incredible source of revenue to the women. So I don't know what you've looked at up there, but I think this area is very similar and could benefit from a visit to the ladies in northern Benin. It's not quite the same languages, but they would benefit from something like that. So just thought I'd throw that out there.
Thanks, Tom.
Thank you, Beat.
Do you have a comment? Okay. Are we okay? I don't know. We good?
We're good, yeah.
Oh, good. Okay.
Okay. Thanks. Good morning, everyone. I'm Mike Robinson. I'm from the Syngenta Foundation. We're based in Basel, Switzerland. The title, Getting the Horse Before the Cart, obviously, I think you're getting a feeling of what I'm going to talk about. The aspect of getting the order of demand right in a seed system is critical in its long-term success. It turns out that that farmers, I guess, have known about getting things in the right order for a long time, and as demonstrated here. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about what I'm going about our foundation, but especially then what we mean about getting it in the right order. What is the demand-led approach to seed system development? We've gone in our foundation a bit further and tried to develop a concept, a service, really, to help push this approach. And I can blatantly say today it's a pitch for partnership, really. We'd like to be able to work with this SIL, the Soybean Innovation Lab initiative, to deliver the outputs of your program, that last mile. I will say something about the success we've had with this approach in the past and ultimately what to, how we hope to be able to work with you. So who are we? We're a nonprofit organization. We're separate from the company. We are independent. We have our own board, increasingly independently funded as well. We have a global focus, generally on pre-commercial, what we call pre-commercial farmers. We're trying to help those farmers that want to interact and work with value chains enter into them, and providing them services and knowledge and technologies. I guess we also could say that we work mainly with pre-commercial crops too. So soybeans, an interesting example here, the type of crop where it is a bit tougher to get that system going. We're global, as I said. We have about 100 staff around the world, but only a very small headquarters based in Basel. Our mission, we are ambitious and want to reach millions of smallholder farmers in a sustainable way. I think that's important, not only environmentally sustainable, but economically sustainable. We want to see a future in farming for existing and for the future farmers too, the young farmers, as we heard earlier. These are the areas where we work, subtropical regions around the world, East and West Africa, South Asia, Southeast Asia, Latin America, and the sorts of crops there, if you can pick up, we work on cereal crops, we work on vegetables, we work on tuber crops too, or clonal crops, and beans too. I guess those two are good examples of difficult crops to get a seed system going in, because of course the temptation is to keep on regrowing the same the same seed as you plant, and as a result you see inevitably a slide in yield and quality. So I'll say something about what we mean about meeting market demand. I guess this model here is the one we're used to as technologists, as scientists, which is to, as plant breeders, to deliver the outputs of our program to a seed producer and a seed distributor, and eventually it gets to the farmers, and the farmers get involved in breeding and replanting that same seed. So therefore, the demand is in that sort of closed loop there. I think what you might classify that as is, to some extent, a technology push system, which organizations sometimes like our own, as donors, get involved in. We would like to see improved technology in the hands of smallholder farmers, but maybe sometimes we are missing the other half of the picture. And that is, below this line here, the the critical factor in long-term sustainability beyond the farm. And increasingly now, as we see farmers getting engaged in value chains, it's what how they're connected into those downstream wholesaler, processor, retailer, and broader consumer markets. We have to consider what their needs are in order to drive the demand from all the way from the farmer going all the way back to the plant breeders. And that's, I think, what we mean by demand-led pull. And that's what we mean about getting the horse and cart in the right order. How do we breed for market demand, and what do we mean by that? I think I can give you an example here, a generic example of on the top left, I think probably something that we're all familiar with and get used to, which is, you know, we're focused on crop performance and resilience, and it's really important to get those traits right. Yield, pest and disease resistance, other agronomic characteristics and environmental adaptation are really important. And that's, as breeders, that's often our primary focus. But if we do that at the expense of those other boxes, then there becomes this risk that we're not playing to the demand in the market, to the broader market, and therefore actually probably to some extent even jeopardizing the long-term success of those farmers that we mean to help in the first place. So we've got to look further than that. We've got to look at how the seed producers and distributors, you know, what traits they need in those crops. So the cost of production, the scale-up properties, and then further downstream on the right, what the consumers want at the end of the day, the taste, appearance, nutrition, of course, nowadays being very high on that list. Cooking qualities too. And then again, especially for this crop, the processing traits are extremely important. And the sooner those processors are brought into the equation of the breeding cycle, and also, you know, the trials and registration of new crops, the better. I've had a go. I should openly disclose here that as Pete said, soybean is new to me too in developing countries. So I don't have that much technical expertise around it, but I've had a go at trying to produce a profile for a tropically adapted soybean. And again, on the top left is probably the characteristics that are high on our list and extremely important, especially the adaptation to day length and related to that altitude, I guess, and some of the other agronomic properties you can see there. But I think some of the other factors, viability, seed viability in the bottom left, extremely important. I think probably seed quality is the thing that's going to drive this value chain at the end of the day. So it's got to be extremely good and controllable. And then on the right, I think there's an interest, of course, in trying to link soybeans, new tropically adapted soybean varieties, into the emerging processing capacity that's building increasingly in Africa and other regions too. So what have we done to try and take this approach forward? We've developed this concept called seeds to be. And what is seeds to be? Well, seeds to be has a number of pillars. Basically, what it's trying to do is firstly work on the left-hand side with the policy aspects of the seed sector, basically trying to encourage regional harmonization and liberalize national policies. There are parts of the world where restrictive national policies are really working against trying to deliver good quality seed to farmers and into those subsequent value chains. So policy is a very important part of it. Then we have two sort of technology transfer models. One on the top, which is about bringing technology from one part of the world to another. So in this case, we'd be looking for tropically adapted soybean from, let's say, Brazil, that you might be able to take into Africa. And then basically assessing it there, basically working with the technology owners to and the local organizations, companies, public or private, that will operate in that new value chain, helping to de-risk that entry. And we then also do full transfer model where we encourage a local production of the seed, and there we'll facilitate licensing, we'll work with the public sector and bridge over to the private sector. Inevitably, it is the small, medium-sized seed company that we work with, as you see. And then most importantly, we're getting the demand side primed for that seed. So straight away, we start to work with processors, start to work with distributors, retailers, off-takers, we call, so there may be contract-based programs to actually encourage demand for the seed at the end of the day. Because if there's no demand there, however good the seed company is, they're not going to be successful. There's other aspects too, like the environment in which that seed is sold, insurance, as I say, credit and savings are extremely important, all issues raised so far this morning. Here's an example of what we're doing in pre-commercial crops. These axes show subsistence versus cash crop and the development of the seed sector. And you can see the green area is the one that we're focusing. The ones in the top right probably are well served already. The hybrid crops, hybrid vegetables, hybrid maize, doing pretty well, and also with strong private sector engagement. We're looking at that green area. Gives you some examples there. I mentioned already beans, potatoes, and cassava. These are all extremely difficult seed systems to get in place. So we have some experience on how you might do that. Soybean, I put there. It's approximately in the right region. And what we hope to do is to work in such difficult areas to help identify opportunities for investment and get local private sector investment coming into that seed system. Here's some examples of what we do already in the last two or three years. So we're doing technology transfer. You can see coming between South Asia and East and West Africa, we do technology transfer from Europe into Africa. We're trying to focus on the certain number of pre-commercial crops, if you like, but increasingly you can see the number of trials that we have to carry out each year is increasing. And I think this year we'll probably be doing close to about 12 or 13,000 different plots in 2013. So you can see the number of companies involved as well, breeders or technology owners. 23 interested parties this year, 110 different varieties. So there's a lot of interest, a lot of demand in this approach to bring technology and move it around to the right place at the right time in the right environment. And what is the environment? I think this gives you an idea of what we mean about trying to develop a demand-led approach. I think if you begin on the left, the breeders, of course, we're familiar with, that's what we do, and then eventually we would like to link them into the seed companies. But of course, the seed companies need some forward market commitments, and that's when it's important for the seed companies to know in ahead what sort of perhaps farmer aggregation exists in terms of organizing farmers to grow for certain value chains, and what sort of other services those aggregations might have, and then ultimately link them to the off-takers, the processors and the canners, etc. And I think I've overlaid that to real examples of where we're working now, lots of different public and private sector breeders, a number of local, medium-sized, small and medium-sized seed companies, extremely important to give these seed companies some long-term confidence to invest, many different farmer aggregators, maybe in numbers of now into the millions, really, of farmers. What we mean by aggregators, of course, is organizations like TechnoServe that work closely with groups of farmers, very important. And then off-takers, whoever they might be, whether they're food companies or whether they are seed companies that want to buy the seed and then sell it on themselves. But at the bottom is the conducive environment. That's extremely important. And I'll say something about what we do in those areas too. A couple of quick examples. One is we're working on ways of de-risking investment in seed production. Of course, buying quality seed is a big outlay for a small farmer. So we've developed micro insurance methods here, extremely affordable micro insurance, fully automated. That's why it's affordable. Basically using satellite automated weather data, crop models, and e-banking to actually make this really cheap and affordable, as cheap and affordable it can get. And this now has got a commercial entity called Acre that we've set up, and basically this will help farmers invest in that seed. It's saying if you have a drought, you get a payout straight away, not in 3 months, but in the same week, and then you can reinvest or take your money and do something else. This is extremely important too, not only loans, debt-based loans, but saving-based loans too. We work with MyAgro in West Africa here. They've got a very interesting scratch card system there for encouraging farmers to save and then invest. I'll quickly tell you about what we've been able to do so far. It gives you an example, a return on investment by taking this approach. Difficult crop, potato. Of course, farmers keep potato seed. It's a clonal crop. But like all farmer-safe seed, it will decline quickly over time, and yields will halve over 3, 4, 5 years. So we invested, So I'm at this slide here now. So this is potato in Kenya. This shows about a 2 million investment in total for putting the seed system together. USAID were involved, GIZ, SFSA, ourselves, $2 million. And basically, I can give you the bottom line, over a five-year period, we're getting a return of about $16 million in farmers' pockets. Now, that's an example, again, where we've worked on is not only the breeding, but also help the seed company to set up, help link him up to the markets, help the farmers link up to the markets. We've developed credit and risk management models for it. And as a result, farmers are quickly benefiting from that investment. I think Rob just made a point saying that, you know, if you have a bag of soybeans, you can sell it. If you have a bag of potatoes, you can sell it too. It's the type of crop that basically takes children through school, really. It's a very important crop, but a very difficult seed sector to get involved with. So finally, I think I just say a couple of words on our offer. What can we offer here? We can certainly help drawing up profiles. We can do trials in many parts of the world, not only Africa, but Southeast Asia, where we know there's a huge demand for tropical soybean. We can work with aggregators. We can work with registration and harmonized registration, taking advantage of our knowledge of how to register in a number of countries at the same time to get the cost down. We work with local partners, seed company partners, licensing negotiations, work with smallholders in all senses in terms of their aggregation, the insurance, credit, and savings, and look at what we call off-taker contracts. So in other words, that's what's looking at the processor and getting them involved in early. This is how you would overlay it, I guess. So it's an example of who the breeders might be, who the seed companies might be, the aggregations that we could work with, the off-taker organizations that are important in keeping this going, and that conducive environment. So that's the horse before the cart in a nutshell. I'd be happy to answer any questions I can. I've got some further information. And in particular, please contact us if you'd like more information, especially Ian Barker, who runs the Seeds to Be program, and would be happy to help. So thanks for your attention.
Thank you, Mike. Questions in the room?
Fawzi Hashim, University of Maryland, Eastern Shore. Actually, I have two questions. The first one, you talked about breeding. Is there any trend or intention to breed for efficient nitrogen fixation with soybean? This will take care of the usage of chemical fertilizers. The second question is, for soybean production in Africa or West Africa in particular, what is the potential processing for soybean in this region? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. For soybean, yeah. Well, thank you for your question. We're not breeders ourselves. Of course, Syngenta's a breeder, but I can't talk for them in terms of what they're investing in now. We know, of course, that there is an interest in NUE or nitrogen use efficiency traits. And I think if there is strong demand there by farmers especially, then it might, it may take hold. If it does lead to farmers getting same yields in a sustainable way over many years, right, using less inputs, then I think it would be a great, great contribution. Question is, does it? We're not quite sure yet whether it does. The second question about processing, I think we heard earlier, there's great opportunities now. There's the feed sector starting up. There's interest in the oil, in oil processing. We're actually looking now in East Africa, at least, to get a map of who are the big processors and what can be, what are they looking at to line them up if there's any interest to move forward in this. So I'm confident that I think I can see demand from processing side for tropical soybean. Yeah.
Great. A question from the webinar. This is from Lloyd LePage and was also echoed by a couple of other webinar participants. Okay. He's joining us from Iowa. And he said, glad to see the emphasis on demand characteristics. You mentioned processing traits, which is an essential component on the food demand side. And the question is, how are you working with private sector processors in Africa to determine their needs?
Well, I can't give you the example yet for soybean because we haven't done it, but we'd love to do it. I'll tell you what how it will transpire. It'll transpire that you get those processes involved in the trials at an early stage. When you're doing trials of 12 different varieties to see if they are adapted, tropically adapted, that's the time when you want those 12 different varieties also to be tested for, you know, oil quality or protein quality or whatever else it is. That's what we did with potato. So we had the people involved at crisping potatoes, especially right at the point where we're doing testing many varieties. It's too late to wait till you've only got one, then they have no choice and no say. So you've got to do it earlier, and the earlier the better. I think that's the answer, Lloyd. I think we've got to do it, and we need people that kind of integrate approaches. I think that's what we're trying to specialize in. We're trying to fill that gap, develop partnerships, public, private, and actually use what resources and capacity we have, some money that we have, to actually get on with the job and not wait for, you know, wait for the outside world to come and fund it. So we know it's a critical gap, and we're prepared to spend our money on that.
Before we take the next question, there is a follow-up answer for the first question.
Hi, I'm Eberson Calvo from TMG Brazil. It's just a comment to the question that the gentleman made. The experience in Brazil, there was a lot of work, not only in breeding for the nitrogen efficiency on the plant side, but there was a lot done in the bacteria, in the rhizobia side. So that's certainly one thing that was a huge contribution for our soybean in Brazil, and I think it's worth doing in Africa too. Okay.
That's a very good comment, that, and probably I should have mentioned more about that. It should be part of the equation here. I think there is a risk that we'll take for granted that the soybean will, you know, just use the naturally available rhizobia, but in reality, I think that's going to be difficult, especially in the tough soil environments. And so actually we're going to have to incentivize, like has been done in Nigeria, works very well there, in terms of we'd like to see more producers of rhizobium, and that's got to be part of the solution.
I'm Dave Meese. I'm a plant breeding consultant. I have a question, actually not for Mike, but more the people in Western Africa, as to over the past 40 years or so, whether there has been a very significant part of consumer preference on the final product to say that these particular varieties are much more acceptable than others in terms of the consumer.
Anyone want to comment to the question?
I think the best way to answer that is they haven't had much choice. Mm. The consumers, for home use, I think is what we're talking about, flavor and things like that. They haven't had much choice. And the processing techniques that they've been using at home level basically take care of the problems with soybean. They grind it into flour, so you don't have to cook it along. You don't have to worry about cooking time. And they cook it, so you don't have to worry about trypsin inhibitor. And then they've had a bunch of flavors, so you don't have to worry about taste. So anyway, that's my, that's the plant breeder's view of what has happened in West Africa.
Yeah, he kind of spoke for the home processors. What we see, the commercial, the large scale processors, they are very keen about the oil content. When they come to us to say we want soybean to process, they are always talking about the percentage of oil they can extract from the soybean. And I always ask them why. They say, well, that is one major product they are processing soybean in West Africa for. But as Ken said, we are very so overwhelmed by the production constraints that we don't, the farmers themselves do not look for the user quality that maybe the people in the US we look for, because they already are producing large volumes. So we try to actually eliminate the production constraints in our work.
Thank you. Question from online.
This is another question from Subramanayam. Sumbar, I think they told me that I could call them. And the question is, have you encountered issues related to GMO versus non-GMO seeds with any of the crops that you have worked with in any of the African countries?
Have we encountered issues? we don't feel that we're in, as a foundation, I mean, I'm speaking for my organization, we don't feel actually we're in a position to really drive the agenda on GM in Africa. It's something that has to be dealt with at the policy level, national level, in combination with the technology owners at the end of the day. As we see, I think probably the success that exists in this part of the world with that type of technology is very much the ability to steward the technology, look after it, be careful with it, and use it in a responsible manner. And I think therefore public-private partnerships are really important in terms of delivering benefits from that technology. When and where they are due to happen in Africa is not something I can give you a definitive answer on.
Again, Sholni Vibad from Michigan State University. I was wondering, you showed some countries where you have a focus on. Is that like just, are you open to working with other countries or?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah, I think those are our bases. I think especially, you know, we work out some hubs. So we actually, although we have an office in Mali, we would work over the 5, 6, 7 different West African countries. Likewise in East Africa. So I think I gave you the example there of the hubs that we have around the world, and where we have some teams and capacity to do work on the ground. But I think you can draw a large circle around those areas where we might actually end up doing the work.
Yeah, my name is David Chikoy. I'm from IIT based in Southern Africa. I wanted to comment on this issue of GMOs. In countries like Zambia, Malawi, Mozambique, I mean, GMO, that's no go zone. I think I remember about a couple of years ago, 5 years ago, Zambia had a shortfall of maize, okay? Then WFP actually imported GMO maize into the country. And the moment senior government officials learned about that, that maize was actually shipped out of the country. If you are importing germplasm, soybean germplasm in Mozambique, one of the requirements as you do the documentation is that we actually have to state whether it is GMO or non-GMO. And if you show that it actually is a GMO crop, you won't be allowed to import the testing material in the country. Actually, as a matter of fact, there is a lot of demand for non-GMO soybean in South Africa. So this actually creates additional market demand for the non-GMO soybean for all those countries which are surrounding South Africa. And also there is demand actually coming from the European markets. A country like Norway, they go out there in Southern Africa looking for non-GMO soybean grain. Thank you.
A question from the webinar. This is from Robert Navin. And the question is, what can be done and by whom to strengthen the linkage between African soybean researchers and African commercial buyers of soybeans in order to shape research so that soybean production is more profitable?
Well, thanks. That's the question just for me, because that's exactly what I'm, that's exactly the type of offer I'm making. And it's interesting that there aren't that many organizations that try and bridge that gap, and would love to see more partners help us. Oh, I could add that we are actually trying to build that capacity in some organizations. So, for example, we're working with the AATF, especially for one of the tech transfer models, and helping AATF understand the process, the regulatory processes that registration has to go through, ownership models, et cetera. So we're trying to build capacity in other organizations too. And AATF are a long-term partner for us. But we'd love to have more partners. Thank you.
Again, Tom Shaw from CRS. I have a question about your weather-indexed crop insurance. In terms of the pricing, the scale, the delivery platform, and what type of reinsurance you're using to manage that. This is one of my specialties, so I'm just curious as to how you're dealing
with it. I can give you much more detail outside of this particular, my standing up here. But out of those, which would you want me to, the cost, as I said, I think we do the best to try and get the cost down almost to the point where it's insignificant extra cost. And there may be some models emerging where the cost to the farmer may be eliminated. There are some models where we're trying, replanting models that we're looking at now, where the seed company itself is happy to carry that risk, providing they know what the risk is. And so therefore, that's one of your other questions, what is the risk? How do we go about that? Well, it's an iterative process of improvement. And I think our experience is very important there to try and engage the risk very accurately so that we can get the reinsurance price down as far as possible. If there's one bit that will help manage the long-term cost is getting the best deal for reinsurance. And so because it's still a new area, really, for reinsurers, they're aggressive still. But I think as competition increases, we hope to get the cost down there. Technology that we're using increasingly involves satellite technology. But of course, that needs to go through a process of ground basing, the combination of two very important. Mobile phone technology is extremely important in the case of East Africa, certainly Kenya, where we've trialed it. And now I think we're looking at probably about 250,000 farmers insured this year, something like that, 250 or 300,000 farmers insured. But if it can be, the route to scale is through the seed companies. We need to encourage them all to take this sort of thing on. And then secondly, also in supporting national programs of insurance, we know insurance is very important for national program, for government policies. And we know, of course, it's extremely expensive. So if we can do anything to help national programs improve their technology, get the local cost down, then more farmers would have access to the benefits of insurance.
Good morning. I'm Annie D. I'm a soybean farmer in Alabama.
Good morning.
And I'm going to address the GMO, non-GMO question that somebody asked a minute ago. I was one of the people that really held out on participating in the GMOs, and I was one of the last non-GMO large farmers in Alabama. And I think Dr. Bertram said it earlier that this is about science. And I think that policy will have to be addressed, and we'll have to help some of those countries in Africa understand that the best genetics are now in GMOs. And if we're going to feed over 9 billion people by the year 2050, we're going to have to try to help them understand the science part of that, and we're going to have to work on that part of it.
Last question from the online participant.
This question is from Dick Tinsley. Again, he's located in Colorado, and he was wondering, Mike, if you have the government support for a certified seed program to oversee the seed certification programs, or will they mostly be on the honor system?
Oh, no. Those countries where we work have governments in those countries have opened their doors. Those that again have more liberal seed policy see the importance of trying to strengthen the seed sector in their countries, and make available to their farmers and subsequently, you know, their food systems quality seed. So we work very closely with governments to adapt their policies, but you raised the very important thing for certain crops is certification capacity is really important. Maybe that's one of the things that's going to be critical for soybean too, in terms of the offer a soybean seed company has. You could have a certified product. Certainly, you know what's in the bag. You know it's clean. You know it's got a whatever 90-something percent germination rate, and you know you know it's got certain oil properties, whatever they might be. But knowing what's in the bag, I think, may be really important bit to get right with putting in place this seed system in Africa for this crop. Thank you. Good question. Yeah. Okay.
One more question from the webinar. This question is from Marshall Martin, and he says, quality seeds adapted to tropical conditions are important, but he's wondering, are you working on best management practices to control diseases, insects, and weeds through either variety selection or educational and marketing programs for pesticide use by smallholders?
Okay. Well, of course, I mean, many people do that too. Of course, all of the researchers here look at the pest and disease resistance. As I said, that sort of those boxes on the left-hand side is bread and butter for breeders. And then in terms of working with farmers to help them carry out the best possible practices in the field, that's a really tricky part, and it's a of course, extension, as we know, can have various forms, and the forms that are most applicable to, let's say, African farmers include and necessitate the support of organizations working at scale like TechnoServe and CRS. It's really important that they continue, as well as the national extension programs, to work together to educate farmers. We'd love to see more of the private sector getting involved in especially technologies like crop protection. They have a duty, and I think mostly carry out that duty of stewardship and training. But the bigger, the longer term answer is continuing to support this. It's an expensive matter, extension. It does need brute force and numbers. It's not particularly scalable. Hopefully, as we get more, I don't know, technology, IT, et cetera, available to farmers, it might, and usable by farmers, then it might get cheaper. But in the meantime, we really depend on the good services of what we call aggregators here, organizations working directly with farmers, whether it's public or private or third sector.
Thank you, Dr. Robinson.
You're welcome. Thank you very much.
Before I introduce our next speaker, just